Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. As we scan our state, love for others brings into clear vision the often overwhelming physical and spiritual needs of millions of Tennesseans. So many drowning in anxiety, despair, depression. Hope feels elusive, but it isn't. The Psalms say that God heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Tennessee Baptists see our state and offer hope to the brokenhearted through a variety of ministries. In times of catastrophic loss, Tennessee Baptist Disaster Relief helps people recover their lives. In times of hunger, Tennessee Baptists provide nourishment for the body as well as the soul. Tennessee Baptist provides support for young, unwed mothers needing help navigating challenging circumstances. But Tennessee Baptists also see opportunities to love countless thousands moving to our state. Evangelism and church planting are priorities, especially in West Tennessee, where the population is rapidly growing because of Ford's Blue Oval City manufacturing plant. And local Tennessee Baptist churches, cooperating with Baptist Collegiate Ministries, are working together to develop the next generation of ministers and church leaders. Tennessee Baptists recognize that any way you slice it, Tennessee is a mission field. There are so many opportunities to serve God and to serve others. That's why support of the Golden Offering for Tennessee Missions is so important. The Golden Offering is to Tennessee what the Lottie Moon Christmas Offering is to the International Mission Board. It helps Tennessee Baptists serve here in our state through strategic ministries and creates new ministry opportunities as God opens doors among family, friends, and neighbors. Would you and your church consider joining other Tennessee Baptists in contributing to the Golden Offering? Together, we can show the love of Christ to those who haven't experienced it by making His love known in word and deed.
While I was interning in the student ministry at Forest Hills, I began to have conversations with Chad about what would it look like for me to go into ministry, and I felt like God was kind of pulling me in that direction, but I didn't really know what that looked like. I threw out the idea of really leaning into some of our BCM ministers that are serving so well on our collegiate campuses across Tennessee. What if we got to hear how God called them to ministry? What was their path toward ministry? How did they do school and serve on campuses? And so we began to plan a trip out across the eastern part of our state. And we met with Jonathan Chapman, who's the BCM director there at East Tennessee State University. And we met for breakfast on May 4th. And before we knew it, the Lord was working, and Jonathan ended up offering Cole a job to serve as an associate at the BCM.
Cole came to the BCM at a pivotal time. We had been growing, literally doubling, the last 2 years before he had arrived. And so becoming our campus missionary and working with us was incredible because he was able to have so much impact on students at the time, not only from an evangelistic standpoint, but from a discipleship standpoint.
Through my 2 years of working at the ETSU BCM with Jonathan, he really showed me what it was like to be in collegiate ministry. But in giving me the opportunities to do ministry, I gained confidence and I understood what it looked like and all the levels of collegiate ministry. And so as I went on from there, I was very confident that this is where God's calling me.
So one of the cool things, in October of 21, Cole had finished up seminary and an opportunity came available at Belmont. And I was so excited to see him be able to go over there and serve there. Ironically, a little bit later on, Mike is having a conversation with me, very similar to Cole, about what the future of ministry looks like. Do I need to be doing college ministry, young adult? What does that look like?
I was sitting in Jonathan's office, just pouring my heart out, struggling with the call to ministry. I'd love to be mentored by pastors in a local ministry context and learn how to do ministry there. And while I'm pouring out my heart to Jonathan, saying, I don't know how we're going to do this, Chad Mize emails Jonathan and says, hey, do you have any students that are graduating that are wanting to learn how to do ministry in a local church context? And Jonathan said, yeah, he's right in front of me.
Forest Hills had the privilege of bringing Micah on as one of our first ministry residents. And guess what? Micah is also serving on our college campuses with our collegiate ministry at Forest Hills, where he also gets to serve in the same spaces as Cole Rogers. What I didn't know is that while Cole was serving at the BCM with Jonathan, Cole was discipling Micah.
Over the course of my years at ETSU, I was invested in by many people. Jonathan poured into me, mentored me, and kind of showed me how to live as a believer. And Cole Rogers also poured into me and discipled me, having weekly meetings and showing me what it looked like to be a young man who had responded to the Lord's call in ministry on my life. The investments from the people at the BCM and from other students around me altered the course of my life forever and helped me respond positively to what the Lord was doing in my life.
At Forest Hills, we've always believed in collaborative ministry through our local conventions. And the Tennessee Baptist Mission Board has really served to be a catalyst for equipping those that we've sent out and also discipling those that we've sent to college campuses. And in this story, we've really seen all sides of that equation really work for the glory of God, the furtherance of the gospel, and really the equipping of the saints for the work of service in the local church.
As Tennessee Baptists give through the cooperative program and the Golden Offering for Tennessee Missions, they make it possible for BCMs to disciple students and also to send them back out as leaders into our local churches here in Tennessee, but also around the world.
The Lord is doing through the state of Tennessee and especially through the Baptist Collegiate Ministry. And so that is a great work that the Lord is doing there. So we are looking forward to that opportunity to being able to continue to support that work along with other different ministries that the state of Tennessee does through Tennessee Baptist Mission Board. If you're visiting with us today or you're a regular attendee, we want to welcome you. If you noticed, if you had an opportunity to pick up a bulletin on your way in, or there may have been one sitting in the pew, but there also is a bulletin and a prayer guide for the Tennessee Baptist Mission Board. And this is for the Golden Offering, and that will be taken up, of course, on September the 15th, that Sunday morning. And the goal this year is $2,945. So continue to be much in prayer for that. Here just a little bit later on in the service, we're going to take a little time and we're going to be praying for Compassion Ministries through the state of Tennessee, through Tennessee Baptist Mission Board. So you be much in prayer for that. Just a couple of things we want to make mention of for everybody. Let's not forget the WMU will meet on Wednesday night, and they will meet at 6 o'clock. And they encourage all ladies that are interested to come and to be a part of that, to attend that. That starts at 6, WMU meeting. And then, of course, we will have regular Bible study, prayer meeting upstairs in the sanctuary. The children and the youth classes will meet on Wednesday night as well at 7. And then after our service, we will have business meetings. So keep that in mind and remember that. Next Sunday, September the 8th, will be Grandparents' Day. And if you would like more information on that, pictures or anything like that, you can see Brooke Simpson, and her number's there on the screen, or you can see her there today after church, so just keep that in mind. And then, of course, choir practice will be coming up Wednesday, September the 11th, and that will be at 6 o'clock. So we've got other announcements there that you can look to your bulletin about, or you've seen them on the screen. Just want to keep those in mind and remember those today in prayer. Has anybody celebrated a birthday this week? Do we have any birthdays? All right. We're celebrating this Labor Day weekend. There's a great verse on the very front of the bulletin, and it comes from Proverbs 16, verse 3, says, "Commit your activities or your work to the Lord, and your plans will be established." And I'd have to say amen to that, wouldn't you? Amen. Thank the Lord for that. Just a praise report I wanted to make mention of. I know we've been praying for Kayla Nolan, and she shared with me there this week, had let us know after, I think it was Thursday or Friday, but there's no cancer. They found no cancer and no Crohn's disease, but they said just with proper medication and dieting, that would help her. So that's an answered prayer. So thank the Lord for that. She still is scheduled for an MRI on Thursday with the possibility of surgery. So keep her in prayer. Remember her. We want to continue to remember Connor, and that is James and Rihanna's son there at UT. So we want to remember him. All righty. Well, let's have a word of prayer today, and we'll get right on into the service. I want to encourage you, mind the Lord this morning. Follow the good Holy Spirit. If God lays a testimony or whatever God lays and leads you to do this morning, I encourage you just to be obedient and mindful of Him. But Brother Kyle, would you open us up in prayer today?
I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Oh,
fellowship with your neighbor, and we're going to sing 56 in the Moles book. Moses stood on holy ground, far from God descended down, set the roadside bush on fire, the bush on fire, and was then the Lord did there explain, through his servant should remain, all the echoes from the bush on fire, all the echoes from the bush, how they thrill my soul.
Oh.
appreciate that song this morning and all the singing. Well, certainly been good to be here already today. I want to take just a minute, though, before we get into God's Word this morning, and I want to take just a little bit of time and talk a little bit about the golden offering, but we also want to have a time just of prayer today for the Compassion Ministries. Now, you may be here this morning, you may ask yourself the question, what is the golden offering? This is a great prayer guide, first off. If you've got one of these in your pew this morning, this is a great prayer guide, and I would encourage you today to start going through and praying for the different ministries throughout the state of Tennessee. When you open it up and you open it up to the big part, you're going to find it gives you a daily prayer for each day. So I would start right on and keep on praying through, and you may get through this week, start over again next week and pray on through. But just briefly, what is the golden offering? And you'll find that on the very first page of when you open up this little prayer guide. In 1902, W.C. and Mildred Golden led Tennessee Baptist to become the first state to have a season of prayer for state missions and to give to a state missions offering. In 1943, the offering was renamed in their honor. 122 years later, Tennessee Baptist contributing through the Golden Offering for Tennessee Missions continue to fund Tennessee ministries. Today, the Golden Offering for Tennessee Missions is meeting human needs through Compassion Ministries, restoring communities after a storm through disaster relief, and sharing the hope of Christ on college campuses through Baptist Collegiate Ministries, and so much more. Pray about how you can reach, connect, and give to state missions through the Golden Offering for Tennessee Mission. So today we are going to begin our prayer guide, and we're going to take just a few minutes. We're going to pray today for Compassion Ministries. Now, I'll say this, our WMU in this church does a great job, and they do several different ministries throughout the year, and they do compassion-type ministries. So if you are interested, if you are a lady and you would like to get involved with that, I want to encourage you to come and be in WMU on Wednesday night. All right, Cheryl, I done a good advertisement, didn't I? All right, good deal. Okay, so ladies, I encourage you, come be a part of that WMU program on Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. But you will find of the Compassion Ministries that they are doing, that this church supports and that we are doing through that WMU program and through the help and the support of Tennessee Baptist Mission Board. We are a Southern Baptist church, and if you know anything, any history on Southern Baptist, we exist for one purpose, one reason only, and that is the mission of God. And what is the mission of God? The mission of God is the Great Commission, right? We are to go into all the world and share the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are to go make disciples. We are to go share the gospel and tell others about Jesus. We are to do that in our own backyard right here in Maynardville and Union County. We are to do that across this great state of Tennessee, throughout the country of North America, and throughout the world, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? So the golden offering is a great thing to support, and I encourage you for us to be able to reach the lost people in the state of Tennessee. If you looked at your bulletin, I believe there was a great percentage on there, 75% of our state. Guys, we've got a lot of work to do, don't we? And you know where it starts? It starts right here in Maynardville. It starts right in Union County, and we'll start right here in our own backyard. And that's why the Lord has impressed on us over the last year or so is this. Man, wherever you live, wherever you work, wherever you play, wherever you do life every day, God has planted and placed you here in this community to reach people and to tell others about Jesus Christ. That's how it starts. If you want to see the numbers of more people in the state of Tennessee begin to increase as far as salvations and following Jesus Christ, listen, guys, it starts right here in Maynardville. Amen? It starts in Union County. It starts in your neighborhood. It starts in your home. It starts in your workplace. Kids, it starts with your friends at school. Guys, listen, I know we got people here that coach Little League teams and different things like that. It starts with influence and encouraging those kids that you're around and having that opportunity opportunity to share with them about Jesus Christ. Amen? So wherever you are, take that opportunity and that door that God has opened up for you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning before we get into His Word. And we're going to pray specifically today for the Compassion Ministry. Let's read this before we pray. Pray for churches ministering to underdeserved populations in their community. We have a part in doing that. Ask that they have wisdom and patience as they build relationships and share the gospel. Guys, it's about building friendships and relationships with people in this community, and that God opens doors and opportunities for us to share the gospel. Pray for churches ministering in jails and prisons across Tennessee. This church has a jail ministry. The women in this church, they will minister to the people that are in the jail right here in this community. Ask God to open the hearts of men and women to respond to the gospel. Man, we need to be praying for those people that are in the jails throughout the state of Tennessee, that are in the prisons throughout the state of Tennessee, that those that are going in and ministering and sharing the gospel, that those hearts of those people, those inmates, would be open to receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and as their Savior. We need to pray for that today. Pray for churches and associations to identify needs in their community and for new compassion ministries that will reach the lost and hurting in our state. I like that last one, don't you? Amen. Read it again. Pray for our churches and associations. We need to be praying that God would help us identify the needs that are in this community. And we begin to pray that God would identify the needs in this community, and pray that God would lead us in new compassion ministries that will reach the lost and hurting in our state. Is that not why we exist? To reach the lost for Jesus. Amen? Let's pray today. Father, we are so thankful for the opportunity that You have given us to be a part of something, Lord, that is so much greater than what we can do as individuals or what we can do as a church. God, You have allowed us to be a part of cooperating churches, Father, in our local association that makes up this great Baptist convention in the state of Tennessee. That, Father, knowing that we are better together, all of us working together for one common goal and reason and mission and purpose, and that is to reach the lost people in our community and in our state. God, we pray that, Father, You would help us as a church and, Father, throughout the state of Tennessee, Father, with the Compassion Ministries. We pray that, God, You would help us, Lord, to identify the needs that is in this community. God, we pray that You would lead us by Your Holy Spirit in more Compassion Ministries and outreaches, Father, that we need to be doing. God, help us, Lord, to have a heart to see the lost people in our community and our state come to know You as their Savior and as their Lord. God, we pray, Father, Lord, that more churches would be planted throughout the state of Tennessee. God, we pray that, Father, more and more people, Your people, would begin to share the gospel, and that, Father, we can begin to see those numbers change, that, Father, more people would become followers and more people would come to the saving knowledge and the understanding of You. God, we love You, we thank You, and we praise You. And all this we ask, Lord, in Your name. Amen. Amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, I would encourage you to turn with us today. We are going to be in the Gospel of Mark this morning, Mark chapter 6, and we are going to be reading and looking, Lord willing, today at the first six verses of Mark chapter 6. And we ask for your prayers this morning. If you would today, stand today for the reading and the honor of God's Word as we read this morning. I encourage you, please, follow right along with us. Mark chapter 1, and starting with the very first verse, the Bible says this, "And he went out from thence and came into his own country, and his disciples follow him. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many hearing him were astonished, saying, From whence hath this man these things? And what wisdom is this which is given unto him, that even such mighty works were wrought by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judah and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? And they were offended at him. But Jesus said unto them, a prophet is not without honor, but in his own country, and among his own kin, and in his own house. And he could there do no mighty work, save that he laid his hands upon a few sick folk and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief, and he went round about the villages teaching. That's all we'd like to read. You may be seated this morning. As we have studied the last Sunday and then Wednesday night, the past two Wednesday nights and then last Sunday, we studied really on Mark chapter 5, and we started with verse 21 through 43. And what you'll find in verses 21 through 43, and even the first 20 verses of chapter 5, what we can find is this: we find Jesus, and he is healing. We find Jesus is performing miracles. The first 20 verses in chapter 5 of Mark, what we read is there is a man from the land of what we know as Gadara. And this man, the Bible said, was possessed with, we believe, thousands of demons and devils. Because when the Lord Jesus asked this man, and the demon spoke, and he asked, he said, "What is your name?" And this man, or the demon, spoke and said, "My name is Legion, for we are many." Meaning the demon was speaking to the Lord Jesus and saying that this man was possessed by thousands of demons. We know Legion to be a term that was used in military as a legion or a company of soldiers. There were many, is what he was saying. So we find here that even in that time when Jesus cast these unclean spirits or these demons and these devils out of this man, we know that he cast them into a herd of swine. And the Bible tells us that there were somewhere around about the number of 2,000 in this herd of swine. And when the demons left this man, that the power and the authority of Jesus Christ, you see, we've got to remember that Jesus has been given all power and all authority by God the Father, hasn't he? And he had that power, he had that authority to cast that demon or that unclean spirit, that legion, those thousands out of this man, and he put them into the swine. And the Bible said that they ran violently down the steep cliff and they choked there in the sea. So we know there was a number of about 2,000, and we find in this story that this man had made his living, that he began to live among the tombs. So we know that this man was possessed. He was crazy. He was a lunatic. He was a madman. The Bible said that there were many times that people tried to chain him or bind him or put him in chains and fetters, but he was so strong that spirit, those demons were so strong in him that he would rip those chains. He would tear those chains apart, and he ran around like a wild man, a man that was just out of his mind, and nobody could tame this man. But there was one day that Jesus showed up. Amen? And when Jesus showed up in the land of Gadara, my friend, the demons had met their match with the Son of God. And listen, Jesus, my friend, touched this man, and he healed him. And the Bible said this man that was possessed, he was clothed and sitting in his right mind. Jesus made a change in this guy's life. He healed him. And we know the story. The Bible said that this man wanted to board the ship and go with Jesus, and he said no. Jesus said, "Here's what I want you to do. I want you to go back to your family. I want you to go back to your friends. I want you to go back home, and I want you to tell them all that the Lord has done for you." And the Bible said that this man did exactly that, and it said that he went into the region of Decapolis. And we looked at that on the map a couple of Sundays ago. That whole region of Decapolis, he went there, and he began to share the gospel and tell people about what Jesus had done in his life. You see, that's exactly what you and I are supposed to be doing, right? When Jesus saves your soul and he makes that change and difference in your life, we are to go to our family and to our friends and to our community and to our state and to our country and to the world, telling people about what Jesus has done in our life, the change that the Lord has done. We find that when we transition from verse 20 to 21, we find there's a man by the name of Jairus. And we know this man Jairus had faith in the Lord, and we know that he came to the Lord and he said, "Lord, I beg of thee, come and just lay your hand upon my daughter. She is sick even to the point of death, but I know that if you will come to my house and you will touch her, she will be healed." Jairus had faith. He had belief in Jesus. We know that while Jesus was on the way to Jairus' house, there was a woman that was sick. She had an issue of blood for 12 years. And the Bible said that she had spent all that she had on the physicians, but she grew worse. She didn't get any better. But she had faith and she had belief. And she said, "You know what? If I could just touch the hem of the garment of Jesus, I believe, I know that I'll be made whole." And we know that the Bible tells us that she reached out, she touched the garment of the Lord, and immediately that issue of blood that she had suffered with 12 years with, she was touched, she was healed, she was made whole, she was healed of that disease. And we know that Jairus got to see that firsthand. And then as soon as Jesus was telling her, he said, "Daughter, your faith hath made you whole." He hears word that his daughter has just died. And what does Jairus do? Jesus looks at him and he says, "Be not afraid," or "do not fear, only believe." And we find that Jesus takes Jairus on home, and he runs out the unbelievers, and he cast out those that were laughing him to scorn, and he got rid of the riffraff. He got rid of those that were weak in their faith, weak in those belief, that was not believing who Jesus was and what he said he could do. As he said, "Listen, the little girl's not dead, for she just sleeps." And they laughed him to scorn. They said, "No, what are you talking about? You're crazy." Jesus said, "Get them out of here. I'm going to touch this girl. I'm going to perform a miracle. I'm going to raise her from the dead. I'm going to bring her back to life. I am going to heal this little girl." And we know that Jesus did exactly that. So I say all that to kind of set the scene this morning of, we read a whole chapter 5 of people that believed in the Lord, right? Whole chapter 5 is about faith and about how people believed and how people had faith and belief in Jesus. And I'm reminded of the man in another account of the gospel that said, "Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief," right? And then we get here to chapter 6, and chapter 6 begins to turn just a little bit. And look what we read this morning. We find right here in chapter 6 that Jesus is rejected at Nazareth, right? We find that it said, "And we went out from thence and came into his own country." Where was Jesus born? Where was he raised? We know where he's born. He's born in Bethlehem. We know they went to Egypt. But when they come back, where did Joseph and Mary and Jesus, where did they settle down? They settled down in a little village, in a little community in the region of Galilee called Nazareth. And that's where he lived, and that's where he grew up. So when Jesus goes back to Nazareth now, he went to Gadara. He healed this man. He's on his way. Healed Jairus' daughter. Healed the woman with the issue of blood for 12 years. Now he goes back to Nazareth in the region of Galilee. And when he gets back to his own hometown, here's what we find. When Jesus goes home, when he goes back to his own country, we find that it says, "And his disciples followed him," right? So we know the disciples are still with him. They're still following Christ. They're going wherever he goes. And that's a great example this morning. And that's a great reminder for you and for me. Listen, if you've been saved by the grace of God, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, we are to be following Jesus wherever he goes. Amen? Let me say that again. If you've been born again, we need to follow Jesus wherever he goes. And what I mean by that is these disciples followed Jesus to Gadara. These disciples followed Jesus to the region of Galilee. These disciples followed Jesus to Nazareth. They were willing to go where the Lord was going. They followed Jesus. And that needs to be for you and I. Listen, wherever the Lord Jesus is leading you and where he's leading me, we need to be obedient and willing to follow him and go, wherever that may be. So we find here the disciples, they have followed the Lord to his hometown in Nazareth. So we get back to Nazareth here, and what do we find? Look at verse number 2. And it says, and when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue. So the Sabbath day, when Jesus gets back to Nazareth, what does he do? Well, he does just like every good Jewish boy or Jewish man or woman or Jewish person would do. They would go to the synagogue, right? They were going to go to church on the Sabbath day. They were going down to the synagogue. And while they were at the synagogue, Jesus goes there on the Sabbath day. And look what he begins to do. The Bible said that he began to teach in the synagogue. Jesus would go to the synagogue and he would teach the Word of God. He would share the Word of God. He would expound on the Scripture. And while he was there, he had a crowd, the Jewish people. They were gathered together. And Jesus would begin to teach. He'd begin to share the Word of God while he was there in the synagogue. But look what the Bible says right here. It says, and when he began to teach in the synagogue, and many hearing him were astonished. There were many that were sitting there that day. No doubt they were locals from Nazareth or from around the region of Galilee. They had come, and as they were hearing Jesus teach and preach the Word and expound on the Scripture, they were amazed, weren't they? They were astonished. You see, this is not the first time that Jesus has been in the synagogue teaching. We have read for at least two or three more accounts previous from Mark 1 all the way up to 6 where Jesus had went to the synagogue, Jesus taught, Jesus preached, and every time Jesus goes to the synagogue and every time Jesus teaches, what happens? People walk away amazed, don't they? People walk away astonished. People walk away with their minds blown by what he knows. Why? Because he is the Word. Amen? John chapter 1 says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We know that Jesus is the living Word of God. We know that the Word became flesh, and it dwelt among us, and we beheld the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So the Word of God, we know, no wonder he could expound. He was the Son of God. He was the Word. And as he was preaching, people were just amazed. They were astonished. Look what it says as we read on. Saying, from whence hath this man these things? And what wisdom is this which is given to him, that even such mighty works are wrought by his hands? I want to read the Amplified Version. I like this as I was studying this week. I think this puts it kind of more into terms of what we can understand this morning. Verse number 2 says, and on the Sabbath he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who listened to him were utterly astonished, saying, where did this man acquire all of this? What is the wisdom, the broad and full intelligence which has been given to him? What mighty works and exhibitions of power are wrought by his hands? What they were saying is, man, this guy's got all kinds of wisdom and knowledge. And where did this come from? Where did Jesus get this? You see, there's a problem right here. Have y'all figured it out? The problem is this. Man, they didn't recognize him as the Son of God, did they? They didn't see him as the Messiah. They didn't see him as the anointed Son of God. They didn't see him as the Savior of the world. And they begin to ask the question. They say, where did this man get these things? And what is the wisdom that he has been given to him? And how are these miracles performed by his hands? So these people that are sitting around the synagogue and they're hearing Jesus and their minds are blown, but they're thinking, man, where is this coming from? How did this old guy, how's this old boy that we know that's grew up right here in Nazareth, how did he get so educated? How does he know all these? How can he do these great miracles and these works? We don't understand it. You see, because they had the wrong perspective. They seen Jesus for who he, what he was, or what they knew him as. They didn't truly see Jesus as the Son of God, did they? Or the man, the God-man. You say, preacher, how do you get that? Well, let's look at verse 3. How did they see Jesus? A couple of things right here. They make it very known to us in verse 3. Three things right here. First off, look at verse 3. It says this. What the question they, or what did they say when they How do they look at Jesus? How do they perceive him? Well, number one, is not this the carpenter? That's how they view Jesus. This guy that's standing up here teaching in our synagogue today, this guy that's got all this wisdom and this knowledge and this understanding, this guy that can perform these miracles and do these great and mighty works and this display of power, is this not the carpenter? Man, that's all they seen him as was the carpenter. They could only see him as what he was. Is this not the carpenter down here? They go on to say, what was the second thing? They said, is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary? You see, they referred to him as, they looked at him as the son of Mary. So two things right here. They're looking at him as the carpenter. They're looking at him as the son of Mary. And they go on to say this. Is he not the brother of James and Joses and Judah and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us? You see, what they were so focused on was the fleshly, carnal, and the natural part of who Jesus was. But they were not focused on who he really was. Amen. That we believe, yes, he was 100% God and he was 100% man. I believe that with all my heart. And he was always tempted and tested just like you and I were. But you know what? He was without sin. But they could not get past the fact that he's a carpenter, he's the son of Mary, and these are his brothers and sisters. And you know what? That affected them. Because what happened when they were not seeing Jesus for who he truly was, what was the repercussion or what was the problem that he couldn't do anything else in that community in his own hometown? Because they couldn't get past to who he was, right? And what they seen him as. But they couldn't see him for what he truly is, the Son of God. You see, what it was their unbelief. We're going to find that out here in just a minute. Look what verse number 4 says. The last of verse 3 says, and they were offended at him. So, he was up there teaching. And he was doing these great, mighty miracles, teaching with all this wisdom and knowledge. And they're like, man, this guy's just a carpenter. He's the son of Mary. We know Mary. We live right down the road from Mary. He was a son of Joseph. His daddy was a carpenter. We know his brothers. We know his sisters. That's all we know him as. This little Jesus that grew up down here, we've known for years. But Jesus says this. That says they were offended by him. Now, why were they offended by him? Well, I believe because he was standing there teaching and preaching the word of God, and they could not get past the fact of what they had known him as their whole life, right? They couldn't see what God was in Jesus and who God was. We find right here, what does he say? Jesus said unto them, a prophet is not without honor, but in his own country and among his own kin and his own house. What is he saying? He said, a prophet is not without honor except in his own hometown, amongst his relatives and his own house. But here's where it gets to. Look what Jesus said, what verse 5 says. And he could there do no mighty work. Jesus could not do any of the mighty work in Nazareth because of the view these people had. And it goes on to say that he could not do any mighty work save that he laid his hands upon a few sick folk and he healed them. And he marveled. Did you catch that? Jesus marveled. Because of their unbelief, period. You know why Jesus couldn't perform the works in Nazareth in his own hometown? Because those people did not believe that he was truly the Son of God. And Jesus marveled at that. And it's amazing. We've got a full chapter 5 of just people that believe and have faith. And isn't it amazing? These people are not even from Nazareth, but where Jesus grew up, not even from his hometown. But we've got this man from Gadara that believed and had faith. And we've got Jairus, which was a synagogue ruler and leader. He was a religious man, but yet he had faith and believed in Jesus and who he was. And then you've got this woman with the issue of blood for 12 years, and who knows where she's from, but yet she's got faith and belief that Jesus is able to heal her. And then we find here what Jesus does in chapter 5, but then we find when he goes home in chapter 6, he couldn't do hardly anything because of unbelief. And church, here's the message this morning is this. How is it that you view the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? How do you view the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? And you see, I believe with all my heart, God is willing and God is able and God desires and wants to do great things in you and in me and in our personal life. Jesus wants to work personally and he wants to work greatly in your life and in my life on a daily basis. But listen, my friend, if we are not willing and we are unbelieving, Jesus is not going to be able to do fully what he desires and wants to do in and through you as an individual and in and through us as a church body. You see, there can't be unbelief in who he is. There's got to be a full, committed faith and belief in Jesus. And we've got to have the faith like Jairus had. And we've got to have the faith like the woman with the issue of blood had. And we've got to have the faith and belief like the man from Gadara had. That we believe, Lord, you're able to do great and exceedingly far above what we could ever imagine or think in our lives. Lord, have your way in us. Amen. He was amazed at their unbelief. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be an individual. And I definitely don't want to be a church that is unbelieving. Faithless in what Christ wants and able and can do. Do you? And I want us to be an individual, and I want us to be a church that man, God, whatever it is, Lord, I understand and I see that, man, it don't make sense. And I don't know how, but God, I know you're in control. And God, I know you're going to make a way, right? And God, I know that you're going to do it. And God, I know that you're able not only to do it, but I know, God, that you want to do this in and through me. And God, I know that I can't do it on my own, but God, I know that you are able to do it in and through us. And what does Jesus tell us? He said, listen, he said, abide in me, right? He said, remain in me. He said, I am the vine, you are the branches. You cannot bear fruit unless you abide or remain in the vine. And the only way we're going to be fruitful for the kingdom of God, and the only way we're going to do great things through and by the Lord Jesus Christ, is if we remain and abide in Him. Because apart from Him, we can do nothing. But the Apostle Paul tells us this in Philippians, says, I can do all things through who? Christ, which strengthens me. Not I can do all things through me, but I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. So Jesus, unfortunately, was not able to do great and mighty things in his own hometown because of the unbelief of the people and because of the way they viewed the Lord Jesus Christ. All they seen him as was the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, Simon, and all his sisters. That's all they seen him as, was those three things. But I'm here to say this morning, guys, he is more than just a carpenter. He's more than just the son of Mary. There's a religion out there that's all they see him as. They see him as the son of Mary. But man, they won't even dare say he is the son of God. I agree with that. He is the son of Mary. But he's much more than the son of Mary. He is the very Son of God. that came and died on the cross of Calvary for you and for me in the sin of the world. So guys, closing here, what does it say? He marveled because of their unbelief. Jesus just was amazed. He marveled. I mean, he was just like, wow. These people can't see you, Father. They can't see what you have done in me. They can't see you in me, Father. They can't get past the fact I'm a carpenter or the son of Mary and these are my brothers and sisters. God, they can't get past that. And it said that he went round about the villages teaching. So what did Jesus do? He seen the unbelief that was there in the village of Nazareth, right? He was only able to touch a few, lay his hands on a few, and heal a few that were sick. He did do some miracles there, but it was very limited because of the unbelief. So what did Jesus do? He did what he was called to do. He did what he was sent here to do. He did what he reminded us, is what he told us back in Mark chapter 1 and 2, and even in Luke. He said, listen, guys, I must go to the other cities, towns, and villages, and I must preach the gospel. For this is why I am sent. Jesus said, okay. The unbelief, I've got to move on, right? I've got to go on. I've got to go to the next village. I've got to go to the next town. I've got to go to the next city. I've got to stay on the go. I've got 3.5 years here, and I've got to spread the gospel. I got a lot of ground. I got a lot of territory that I could got to make up right here. I've got a lot of places to go to share the gospel. Man, you think about that for just a minute. Jesus knew he had 3.5 years, right? 3 1/3. And he knew that he had to be going and sharing. He had to be working. Man, could you just imagine? Think about this for a minute. How much motivated and how much more inspired would you be and I be that if we knew we only had 3.5 years left to live and that we've got to spread the gospel as far and into as many people as we can in 3.5 years? You know what the sad thing about it is we're not even promised the next breath. We're not even promised the next breath. We're not even promised the next day. So we don't even know if we're going to make it out of here, right? We need to be living our lives that, man, this may be it, right? That we need to be telling as many people as we can about Jesus and going to as many places and people that we can to tell them about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That's why we are called. It's why we've been saved. It's why we've been sent. It's to go to the cities, the towns, the villages, and share the gospel and tell them about Jesus Christ. Amen. Church, I want to encourage you this morning. Have faith and have belief. Let's not be like Nazareth, right? Let's not be unbelieving. But let's have faith and let's have belief. And let's be as that prayer and that man in the Bible and the gospel says, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. Amen. Let's have the faith of Jairus and let's have the faith of that woman with the issue of blood for 12 years. Let's have the faith and belief like the man from Gadara. Let's have the faith and belief of all those ever before from Mark chapter 1 all the way up that Jesus has touched and healed. Let's have the faith like those four friends that bore that one man. They brought him to Jesus. What'd they do? They went to the extra extreme, didn't they? They got him up on the roof. They tore that roof off and they lowered him down right in front of Jesus. You see, these men had faith and belief and they loved their friend and they wanted to get this friend to Jesus. Why? Because they knew if they could, Jesus could heal him. We ought to be that way. We got friends, we got families, we got coworkers, we got people that we know that don't know Christ. And man, if we could lead them to Jesus, we know that Jesus could make such a change and difference in their life, couldn't he? I want to encourage you. Let's do that. If they want to come get a song this morning, let's begin to pray as we bow our head, close our eyes today as they come get ready. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this morning. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Father, for today. We thank you, Lord, for just the scripture today, Father, that, Lord Jesus, we know that, God, you are more than just a carpenter. We know that you're more than just the son of Mary. We know that you're more than just a brother to your brothers and sisters and your earthly brothers and sisters. Lord Jesus, we know that, Father, you are the great physician. We know, God, that you're the great master builder. Lord, we know that you are the very Son of God. that came and died on the cross of Calvary for our sin. Father, help us, Lord, not to be unbelieving or doubting or unfaithful. But Lord, help us, Lord, to have faith, and help us, Lord, to be a people that do believe in You. And just as that man in the Bible, as he said, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. Lord, I have faith, but my faith is weak. Lord, strengthen our faith today. And help that part of us that doesn't believe. Lord, help us not to fear, but as You told Jairus, to fear not, or to not be afraid, but only believe. Lord, I pray that You would encourage and strengthen our belief and faith in You today. God, we love You so much. We thank You. And all this we ask, Lord, in Your name. Amen. As we stand to our feet this morning, the altar is open. If you feel the need to come and pray, I encourage you to come right on and mind the Lord as they sing.
Jesus, keep me near the cross, there a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain, in the cross, be my glory ever.
Praise the Lord for allowing Dan and I to spend time with our grandchildren, getting us there safely, and giving us the strength to watch our grandchildren, as well as giving us our grandchildren, because I know it's only through Him that He gave us a joyful heart to do that, not just physically, but to, in every way, to try to pray to them. So I really thank Him for that.
Appreciate that. Anybody else? Question this week, what has God been teaching you? And because I feel like that's what He has been teaching me. And I feel like that He's been teaching us as a church is faith and belief. And I want to just encourage you all today, have faith, have belief in the Lord. And just as Jairus, as we learned Wednesday night, when Jairus had that faith, but it seemed like on that journey to his house for his daughter to be healed, what happened? Just seemed like the bottom fell out of it, didn't it? He heard the words, "Your daughter is dead." And we're going to have times like that in our life, aren't we? Just, man, the bottom's going to fall out on our journey through life. But what happened? He said that Jesus looked over at him and said, "Be not afraid, only believe." So I encourage you today, faith and belief. Have that this week. I believe that God has really been teaching us that. the last couple weeks. So I thank the Lord for that. Well, it has certainly been good to be here this morning, and I guess it's time to go, ain't it? I'm going to ask our young men if they'll come and receive our morning offering. As they're coming, I encourage you just to give today out of a joyful heart. Whatever God has given you and laid on your heart to give, we encourage you to do. You can give through the plate today, or you can give online as well. If you noticed in the bulletin, there is a QR code that you can scan and you can give online that way. If that is an option for you, we encourage you to do that today. But it has been certainly good to be here. I hope and pray that everybody will enjoy the rest of their day, enjoy the long weekend, and I hope you get to spend time with your family and friends and just get to relax and enjoy that. So, Lord willing, we'll be back Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. WMU meet at 6. Let's go a-praying. We'll come back a-praying, looking forward to what God has in store. I'm going to ask this morning, Brother Rick would dismiss us in prayer.
Thank you.